स्क्रीन। सो नाउ द डिस्पर्शन बेसिकली मीन्स दैट ओमेगा इज एक्चुअली अ फंक्शन ऑफ क्यू। ओके, एंड दिस क्यू हैज थ्री कॉम्पोनेंट्स, क्यू एक्स, क्यू वाई एंड क्यू जेड। सो द ओमेगा इज बेसिकली अ फंक्शन ऑफ थ्री डिफरेंट वेरिएबल्स इन थ्री डायमेंशंस। नाउ यू कैन ऑल्सो हैव ए ब्रांच इंडेक्स, सो देर वुड बी ए ब्रांच इंडेक्स एज वेल। एंड वॉट दिस मीन्स इज दैट देर इज एन इंटीजर अल्फा एंड देर इज अ क्यू एक्स, क्यू वाई एंड अ क्यू जेड। सो देर इज ए फंक्शन विच मैप्स दीज फोर वेरिएबल्स, दिस इज जस्ट अ नेचुरल नंबर, एंड दीज थ्री, दिस क्यू एक्स, क्यू वाई, क्यू जेड आर रियल नंबर्स। इट मैप्स ऑन टू वन रियल नंबर विच इज ओमेगा। ओके, सो दिस ओमेगा इज ए फंक्शन ऑफ मेनी डिफरेंट वेरिएबल्स। वॉट वी कैन डू इज वी कैन कंडेंस दिस इंफॉर्मेशन इन टू अनदर क्वांटिटी कॉल्ड डेंसिटी ऑफ स्टेट्स, एंड द डेंसिटी ऑफ स्टेट्स इज ए क्वांटिटी विच हेल्प्स अस टू अंडरस्टैंड हाउ मेनी स्टेट्स आर अवेलेबल एट अ सर्टन एनर्जी। ओके, विच मीन्स लेट से वी आर प्रोबिंग द सिस्टम एट सर्टन एनर्जी स्केल्स, दैट एनर्जी कुड बी वेरी लो, वेरी हाई। फॉर एग्जाम्पल, यू आर शाइनिंग सम काइंड ऑफ इलेक्ट्रोमैग्नेटिक रेडिएशन ऑन अ पर्टिकुलर सैम्पल। Okay, and that radiation has certain amount of energy, so that those photons have a certain frequency, so which means that you are probing the system at that particular energy because you want to cause, let's say, electronic transitions, or you want something in the system to absorb that photon. Okay, now whether or not states exist at that particular energy will determine whether the incident radiation will interact with the system or not. Okay, if there are no states at that energy, this electromagnetic radiation will not be able to interact with the sample, which means you will not be able to get any information. Okay, so the density of states is that particular quantity which gives you that information that okay, at a certain energy scale there is a certain density of states that exists. Okay, so this is a very important quantity, and this quantity comes from the dispersion relation. So if you know the dispersion relation, which means energy as a function of k, then from that you can figure out what is the density of states. Okay, so let's look at this concept. Now the density of states, as you might have read in many other courses, it's given by sum over k, okay, of e minus ek, right? So what is this saying? Okay, so let's think about this concept for a little while. Okay, let me take you to a different context first. Okay, let's imagine that I have a few charges placed in empty space. Okay, this is charge q1, q2, q3 and so on, and this is a discrete set of charges. And now I give you another situation, which is this, and this object has a charge q and a volume v. Okay, uniformly distributed charge q over a volume V. So can somebody tell me what is the charge density in this system?
Q by V.
Exactly. So now can you extend that same concept and tell me what is the charge density for this system, for this discrete set of charges?
I think it will be sum over Qi by sum over Vi.
Okay. Now so you are saying that there is a small volume that this occupies, and then
yes,
q1 by v1 plus q2 by v2 plus so on, you think that will be the charge density, correct?
Yes, okay. Actually I am confused that should I take some volume element within which the whole charge distribution will be occupied.
Okay, yeah, I will take something like this. So let me say that the total volume is some omega. Fine. And yes, now you are saying that you are confused whether you should take q1 by omega or q1 by the small volume.
Yes.
Okay.
Yes.
So now suppose you take either one of them. Okay. First of all, if you take q by the big omega, what you are implying is that the q has been distributed all over this volume. Because yes. That is what you did here, right?
Yes.
But that is not true, isn't it? The Q is a point charge. It is localized in a very small volume, which means that we have to find out the charge density only in that volume. Okay. Even this argument has the same flaw. Because if you look at this, there is a Q1 by V1 plus Q2 by V2 and so on. Okay. But if I look at this point, there is no charge here. So at this point, the charge density should be zero.
You can use delta function.
Yes, it will be a sum of delta functions. So the question is, why should it not be Q1 by V1 plus Q2 by V2? The simple answer is, if you take it like this, then again you will get a charge density which is uniform in this entire volume. Okay, but we know that the charges. Okay, so right. One second. Yeah. So it's localized only at these points, which means that in the other parts of this volume, there is no charge at all. So the charge density should be zero there. Okay. Now let's take a different angle to this. Okay. So this charge density. Okay. Let's take this charge density. Okay. And then keep making this volume smaller and smaller. Okay, so which means I'm going to take this and then make this smaller. Then I'll take this and make it even smaller. Then make this even smaller. What do you think is happening to the charge density here?
The charge density will increase.
Very good. Okay, now I will take this and as you had said, let's put this in some box. And the box size remains the same. So sorry for my drawing, but basically this is also inside the box whose volume is the same. Okay. The box volume is not changing. Let's consider that. Right. Now, in this case, the object occupies the entire space, entire volume almost. In this case, the box volume is much larger than the object volume. In this case also, it is much larger. In this case, it's even larger, right? Now, in this case, what do I say for these parts? In this part, the charge density is zero, right? And in this part, the charge density is Q by the small v, which is tending to infinity, okay? But if I take this full box and integrate the entire charge density over this, so find something like rho of r d cube r over the volume. I get the same quantity for this. I get Q. In this case also, I get the total charge Q. In this case also, I get the total charge Q. And in this case also, I get the total charge Q. Which means that the total charge inside this omega volume remains the same. But the charge density is going on increasing only in a small volume and everywhere else it is zero, right? But the total weight or the total weight under this total area under the integral remains the same. So this kind of a quantity is represented by a delta function, Q times delta of R minus R zero. So this delta function is basically the approximation of a small rectangle whose width is going on decreasing. Let's say the width is 2a and the height is 1 by 2a. If I go on decreasing this width, but so which means a goes to 0, but 1 by 2a will go on increasing. Okay. So if the a becomes smaller, this rectangle becomes even more skewed and it becomes even more skewed and so on. Okay, so the limit when a goes to 0 is called a delta function. And that is what is happening here. That this charge or the charge density inside this big volume becomes the Q. Q is the total charge multiplied by a delta function. Right. Now, why did I bring all this discussion? I brought this discussion because this is relevant for the definition of the density of states as a sum over delta functions, but now in K space. Okay, so what are we saying here? We are saying that let's say that there are certain levels, energy levels in a system. okay, and these are, for example, discrete levels. So these, this is EK, this is K1, K2, K3, K4. So at the momentum K1, there is an energy EK1 and EK2 and so on. Okay, but these are all discrete levels in the same way that these are discrete point charges. So for this, I want to find out the density of states. In this case, we found the charge density. In this case, we are finding the density of states. So in what regions of the energy space are the states present? So here we are asking, in what region of the volume in real space are the charges present, right? So here we are asking, in what region of the energy space are the states present? Okay, so that is why, because these are all discrete, they don't occupy any finite volume, but they have a certain weight. Okay, and each of them has a weight which is equal to 1. Here the charge density would have been sum over qi delta of r minus ri. Okay, this is the charge density for this particular case, and the qi is the charge of each point charge. Right, now here you see the definition is very similar to that, except that we are doing a sum over delta functions with an equal amount of weight, because every state counts as one state. Okay, so it's basically the similar definition as the charge density, but it's a sum over the k space states. Okay, and what this is counting is that whenever the energy becomes equal to one of those states, you get a delta function. Okay, and the sum over all such momenta in the system will give you the full density of states. Okay, so this definition involves the Dirac delta function, and if anyone is not familiar with certain operations on the Dirac delta function that we are going to do now, then please let me know. Okay, there are very nice articles on the Dirac delta function, very simply written ones. I can refer you to those. Okay, so we are going to now look at the density of states of phonons in different dimensions. Okay, and from that we will also figure out what should the specific heat look like and so on. Okay, and the density of states will also be important, for example, in understanding phonon transitions. When we look at thermal conduction, for example, or even when we look at, you will see, when we look at Raman scattering, for example, okay, we will need the density of states concept, right? So let's just look at this. In fact, these days, there are something called topological insulators, but then you can also have things for phonons as well. You can have topological order for phonons as well. So that also enters through this density of states concept. And if the density of states has topological properties, then for phonons also you can have topological properties. Okay, so the density of states is a very important concept, and let's just try to evaluate this for a very simple case. Evaluate this for the Debye model. Okay. Now, why do I say Debye model? The Debye model basically says omega of k is some c times k. Okay, notice here that there is a vector, and this is just mod of k, so it's a scalar. Okay, so it's a scalar. So in some sense, what we are saying is there is an isotropic dispersion, right? Because it doesn't depend on kx, ky, kz individually. It is only dependent on the mod of the k vector, right? So this is the Debye model. And for this Debye model, I want to evaluate this density of states. Okay, so the density of states is given by sum over k delta of E minus Ck. Right, now this sum over k, because this k is over minus pi to pi, minus pi by a to pi by a, right? But this is mod k, so this is only from 0 to pi by a, so only over this interval. Now what we can do is, this sum over k can be converted to an integral. Convert to an integral. And this is also a standard procedure.
So there will be an h cut?
I'm sorry? Go ahead. Can you repeat that?
Sorry? Yeah. There will be an H
where there is nothing quantum about it. See, there is no Planck's constant here. Okay, see, all we are saying is, see, when you treat classically the phonons, you will get a certain dispersion relation, right? And whatever system you are working with, whether that is a classical system or a quantum system, you can always find the density of states for that system, irrespective of the quantum nature or the classical nature of that system.
Sir, okay? I think he wants to compare the dimensions.
Okay.
CK will not give the will not be the of the dimension of E.
I see what you're saying. Okay, so so that's why you want to bring in H cross, is it? You want to say that H cross omega is the energy scale?
Yeah, yeah.
Well, okay. So if we start from the classical case, okay, then there is no H cross, isn't it?
Yeah.
So if we start from the classical case,
how the energy comes into play?
Okay, let's go back to the Hamiltonian. Okay, and there would be. Let me see. Okay, so it's there is a the omega comes out to be just the frequency. Now let me see.
Sir, it is dimension wise this is correct only, because omega is the frequency and this is the velocity of a sound, then this is wave vector. It's correct only.
So the dimensions of this would be meters per second.
In meter per second.
And this would be meter.
And this is 1 by second.
K is 1 by meter, right? So this is per second then. So this is just the frequency. So what he is saying is, to make this dimensions of energy, we actually need H cross. Okay. And I'm arguing that no, this is a classical object, and one should be able to go back to the classical Hamiltonian and see that. But what I'm finding is, in the classical expression, if we look at the dimensions of energy, it's actually half m omega squared x squared, right? And if we look at this one, it's p squared by 2m. So I'm actually confused here. There should not be any H cross. So interesting.
Can't we take d of omega?
No, we can. See, that's the simplest solution, that we can just find the d of omega. But it's an interesting question in itself, that what would be the dimensions of energy in the classical case? I mean, what would give us the dimensions of energy in the classical case? Okay. And that I'm finding is half m omega squared x squared. So, but we are actually,
sir,
when we find the,
sir?
Yes, yes.
Sir, if we don't consider H cut, then CK will be just a frequency. Then the definition of density of states means the number of energy states per unit volume or area per unit energy range. Now, if we don't consider the energy scale, then it will be the density of states will be, if we take only CK, then the density of states will be number of phonon state per unit wave vector, or something like that, but not per unit energy range.
I don't believe that.
Okay, sir.
Phonons are not purely classical, right? This is semi-classical.
No, but what we are saying is that, let's say you start from a purely classical Hamiltonian, okay, which has just the harmonic oscillator part and the momentum part and the kinetic energy part, even then you can derive a dispersion, correct?
Okay.
So with that dispersion, then you should be able to find out the energy, and this is where I'm getting a little bit confused. So I mean, and the simplest resolution is just go to the quantum case and just call it h cross omega. But what would be the analog of this in the classical case is what I'm not getting it offhand. Okay. So yeah. Yes. You cannot, but yes, the sir. Question is that you can have a classical description of a certain object. Okay. When you quantize it, you get the correct temperature dependence and other quantities. Okay. But what you will see is that the quantum nature, the density of states at the quantum level and at the classical level depends purely on the dispersion. So in that case, can we find the dispersion at the classical level itself? Okay. You will see that the answer to the classical or the quantum level depends only on how you assign the energy. So as he said, energy, if we call it h cross omega and then h cross ck, then the h cross is entering there. But suppose we don't want to do that. Okay. And we say that there is a, so instead of calling this d of e, as he suggested, let's call this d of omega. Okay. And this would be then the density of states of the frequency, not of the energy itself. Right, then we will say that at a certain frequency, can we find phonons or not? That would be the resolution to this. Okay, but the question is interesting, that what is the analog of this energy, or what is the analog of the Planck's constant in the classical case? Okay, so there are actually analogs, because if you look at the phase space, okay, the sir, phase space in, yeah.
Sir, can I make a comment here?
Yes, yes, make a comment, yes.
Sir, since we know that the de Broglie relationship, we have P is equal to H by lambda.
Correct.
And which is equal to H cut K.
Correct.
So if we know the K vector, we can know P. And cannot we convert that to energy, but we require mass there, P square by 2m.
There is a problem, Kanaya. The problem is this. See, if again you're bringing the Planck's constant, because the de Broglie relation, it actually connects the momentum and the wavelength, right? And there is a Planck's constant sitting there. Okay.
Yeah.
But what we have just discussed is that you can get the phonons as classical waves itself. So they are waves even classically. You don't have to consider their wave nature as a special thing. You know, starting from the particle nature, you want to extract the wave nature, then you will use the de Broglie relation.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
So here we want to do a honest classical description. And if you want to do an honest classical description, what would be the analog of the Planck's constant? That's the question.
Okay.
You understand? Okay. So,
yeah.
See, one thing is that the energy of the system, the total energy of the system is actually half p squared by m plus half kx squared. If I want to do a simple single harmonic oscillator, or this is half m omega squared x squared, and this in the quantum case becomes h cross omega times n plus half. Okay, but in the classical case, if I look at the energy of this system, then it's basically given by m omega squared a squared, where the a is the amplitude of the oscillation. If I keep the energy as a fixed number, then I get total energy as m omega squared a squared. Okay, so here the energy seems to be dependent on omega squared, whereas the energy in the quantum case seems to be dependent on omega. Right, so that is probably the dichotomy here, that if we want to consider the phonons as purely classical, then maybe the energy will depend on omega squared, and you would have to consider then here ck squared or something, but that is also not true. Okay, so let me try to resolve this. Okay, I will make a note of this, and if somebody has a resolution, please propose. We can argue about this. but I had not thought about this question. So thanks. There are many things which which you keep doing without actually thinking, and this is probably one of those. So, the resolution, the quantum case is very simple. You can just call this delta of omega minus ck, or you can say d of e is sum over k delta of h cross omega minus h cross ck. Okay, so that's the simplest way to resolve this, right? But what to do classically, I will find out and tell you. Okay, is that okay?
Yes, sir.
Okay.
Yeah. But do think, this is an interesting question. So let's take this definition. Yeah, I was telling you about the phase space also. So it turns out that if you look at the phase space, even classically, okay, if you look at the phase space, which means X versus P, then an area element in this phase space is actually delta X times delta P. Okay, and this actually has the same dimensions as the Planck's constant, right? Because from the uncertainty relation, you know this. So, but this is a classical picture, and this is a quantum mechanical picture. So the delta X times delta P can be given, there are certain dimensions, or classical scenario also, you can assign certain characteristic quantities to the delta X and delta P. For example, the amplitude is like delta X. So, but I'm not, see, this is all a very hand-waving argument. So let's not go into this. I'll find out something rigorous and then come back. Okay. So, nice. Okay. So let's find out for the Debye model. And in the Debye model, the dispersion relation is omega k is c d of whole cube, okay, delta of omega minus ck. So then this dk is basically 4 pi k square dk. So we will use the spherical polar coordinates, because the k integral 4 pi k square dk times delta of omega minus ck. Okay, so can somebody tell me what would be the answer for this? Forget the proportionality constants. What will be the answer for this in terms of omega to the power what? What should come here?
Omega by c to the power
square. Omega by?
C square.
Omega by t squared.
Square c. Omega by c whole squared.
Omega by c whole squared. Okay, okay. Omega by c whole squared. Okay. So the reason you said that is because k equal to omega c is where the delta function blows up. So if I look at this, the roots of this are basically k equal to omega by c. Correct? And from that, you just substituted into this k and you got omega by c whole squared. Very good. Now, what are the other factors here? So this is omega by c squared. Are there any other factors that will come out? So if I say delta of ax and I want to relate that to delta of x, what is the factor?
I think it's 1 by magnitude of a.
1 by mod a. Very good. So we should use that here, right? We should convert this first to that form, which is delta of omega by c minus k, right, with a 1 by c outside. okay, and then the 1 by c will come out and you will get a 4 pi squared c here, and then this k equal to omega by c will go and hit this and you will get a omega by c whole squared, right? So
sir, will that be 4 pi squared or 2 pi squared?
2, yeah, thanks. Correct. So the important point to see from here is that this is proportional to omega squared, right? Now, is there dimensionality, is the dimensionality of the system important in determining the power of this omega? Or to rephrase the question, suppose I had been in two dimensions or in one dimension or in d dimensions, what would be the dependence of the density of states on omega?
Sir, it will depend because...
Yes. Okay, yeah, it will depend
d
on...
D minus 1.
Yeah, you're right. The answer is D minus 1. Can you show that? How will you show that?
Yeah, that integrating factor dk is there.
Correct. So
if we will integrate it in n dimensions, so the factor we are getting is n minus 1 dimensions there.
Okay. Very good. So the dk in d dimensions would be some constants involving pi and other things, and there would be a k to the power d minus 1 times dk, right? In spherical polar coordinates. Okay.
Yeah.
And because of this k to the power d minus 1, you will get an omega to the power d minus 1. Very good. So given this, okay, given that the density of states is omega to the power d minus 1, and as a special case, we got omega squared, right? So can we now argue using this density of states that the specific heat is proportional to TQ? We got this for the acoustic branch, right? And what we are doing here is also for the acoustic branch. So can we use the density of states directly and argue that C should be proportional to TQ? Any arguments?
Sir, I could not understand the question.
Okay, so the question is this. See, remember the way we derived the specific heat expression, how did we derive it? We actually went back to the dispersion, right? And we basically then found out what is the energy of the phonons, and then we used the Bose-Einstein distribution, we used the dispersion relation also, and then we did a sum over k and we found that C is proportional to TQ, correct?
Yeah.
Now I'm asking you, now that you have found the d of omega as omega to the power d minus 1, right? Okay. Can we use directly this relation and argue that the specific heat should be proportional to t to the power d in d dimensions?
We can write energy as density of state multiplied by energy of each particle.
Okay.
And then
so this is the average energy is the this times the density of states times
d omega.
Okay. So by writing this, you're missing one factor. What is that? You're almost there.
Sir, Bose-Einstein distribution.
So what you are Bose-Einstein distribution, very good. So what you are saying is that at a certain energy omega, right, there is a certain density of states, okay, and the energy of those states is given by omega itself, right?
Yeah.
But are all those states occupied with equal probability? No, right? So the states will be occupied with a certain probability, and that probability has to be included into this integration. Okay. So given this, Now let's take this this density of states relation that we have found, okay, and substitute this. So we will get omega to the power d, right? And then fb of omega is basically e to the power omega by t minus 1 times d omega, okay? And now what we see is that if we substitute omega by t everywhere, then we will get t to the power d plus 1 integral x to the power d dx divided by e to the power x minus 1. Okay. So what we find is that the energy is proportional to t to the power d plus 1. And this would imply that the specific heat, which is proportional to del E bar by del T, is proportional to T to the power D. Okay, so it's a very general argument that the specific heat for the acoustic branch should be proportional to T to the power D. Okay, so this is all for a linear dispersion, right? Now, let's do a slightly more complicated calculation, and that will bring us to another concept, which is the concept of the Van Hove singularities. Okay, so let me clear this.
Sir?
Yeah.
Hello?
Yeah.
Yes. Sir, I have a question from previous slide. So there was a delta function, delta of omega minus ck. So it is acoustical approximation. Now when we go for optical zone, then the frequency we take, you said that we take a constant value. Then there will be a constant value. Then how can we integrate integrate over the k space? So the here the integration is resolved by the delta function. But if we go for optical zone, then the integration cannot be resolved by the delta function. So,
It will be. So the you are saying that delta of omega minus omega naught. That's what you have, right? Yeah. Where omega naught is independent of the k, correct?
K. Yes, a constant.
It's a constant. So basically, then the density of states is just equal to delta of omega minus omega naught times n. Okay. Okay. It just remains like that. The reason is that if you look at the dispersion, then you just have one single energy level, right? Or in quantum mechanical terms, but in the classical terms, you have only one normal mode, okay? At frequency omega zero. Now let's take this and find the specific heat contribution due to this. Okay, so that is possible to do. So let's do the same thing that we did for acoustic phonons, which is d omega times the density of states times the Bose-Einstein distribution. Okay, if we do this, then what do we get? We will get omega times n times delta of omega minus omega zero times fb of omega, and this whole thing results in just omega naught divided by e to the power n times omega naught divided by e to the power omega naught by t minus 1.
Oh, that's why exponential decaying function is coming. Okay.
That's it. Okay, so when temperature is very small, you will basically, this will be very large, and this will
and
be
it will go to after
yes,
I understand.
Yeah, okay. So yes, whenever there are isolated levels with no dispersion, you will basically get delta functions as the density of states. You can't do anything more to that. So this happens in electronic systems also. So for example, if you take quantum dots where there are isolated levels, then the density of states will remain as a series of delta functions. They will not be broadened out. Okay? In the case of acoustic phonons, we saw that the phonon had a clear dispersion. Because the phonons have a dispersion, the density of states is a broad function. It's omega to the power d minus 1. Okay? But and that's a broad function as a function of omega. But if you don't have a continuum, continuum in the states, then your density of states will be a series of delta functions. Okay, so let's now go to a realistic case, which is monatomic 1D lattice. Right, so let me ask now, is Surabhi Menon there?
Yes, sir.
Ah, Surbhi, have you been asking questions in the class? No, right? I don't remember. Okay, or maybe I don't recognize the voice, so I'm sorry. If you have asked, then it's okay. But if you have not asked, then let me ask you.
Okay, sir.
Yeah? So, what is the dispersion for the monatomic 1D lattice for phonons?
It goes omega square.
No,
the energy.
Not the energy. We are asking about the dispersion. Dispersion means what is the dependence of the energy or the frequency on the k, on momentum. For a 1D monatomic lattice?
K square, sir?
No. See, it's never k squared, first of all. Okay, it's always linear, or near the Brillouin zone edge, it's actually flattening out. Now, do you remember what was the function we found? So, tell me, what does this function look like to you? This function?
It's a sine function.
Sine function, right? Now, do you get an idea what this function was?
Sine squared we took.
We got sine squared, right? So, yes, we got omega k squared as 4k by m sine squared Ka by 2. So, can you tell me what is this capital K here? And what is this capital M here?
So, M is mass.
Mass of?
Mass of the atom that we are taking.
Okay, mass of the atom. That's right. And what's capital K?
So it's the spring constant.
Okay, very nice. And what's the small a?
So it's the lattice constant, that lattice distance.
That's right. Okay, so this is fine. Now let's take omega. So thank you, Subhi. So let's move on, and then let's take this dispersion. Okay, so omega k squared is 4k by m sine squared k by 2, which means omega k is 2 root k by m mod of sine ka by 2. And this dispersion will obviously look something like this, right? And now we are asking that this is omega k and this is k. So we are asking, let's say at a certain energy, right, at a certain omega, how many, or what is the density of states in this energy range, in the d omega, how many states are present? Okay, so even before we do the calculation, let's just make a quick estimate. Okay, so do you think in the k tending to 0 region, or in the k tending to pi by a region, where will the density of states be higher? Will the density of states be higher at the Brillouin zone edge, or will the density of states be higher in the acoustic, in the k tending to 0 region? What do you think? Anyone?
Zero point. At k tending to 0, okay, it will be higher.
K tending to 0, the d of e or d of omega should be higher. So, what is your argument for that?
Because at Brillouin zone, it is almost flat, and for a large variation of delta k, we have a small variation of delta omega, so it will be very small. But in near to k equals to 0, it will be linear or proportional, and okay, for a small variation of delta k, there will be large variation of delta omega.
Okay, so good that you said this. But let me tell you, the answer is exactly opposite. Okay, so let me argue why. Fine, and you tell me where your argument failed. Fine, so let me just zoom on this. It's like this and then like this. Now remember, the density of states is given by sum over k of delta of omega minus omega k. So what we are doing is, we are fixing the omega. So, we are fixing the omega, let's say either here or here. Okay, so if we fix the omega to be near the Brillouin zone edge or to be near the k tending to zero, right, small omega or large omega, then this omega is fixed here. And the delta function is going to blow up when any omega k becomes equal to omega. Okay, so we are basically counting that if we take the same d omega here and if we take the same d omega here, okay, it's the same energy range that we take in both the places, then how many k values contributes to this energy range? Okay,
okay, so that means at k tending to 0, there will be small k values, and at k tending to Brillouin zone, it will be large k values. And exactly. As we are fixed in omega, so it will be large in near Brillouin zone.
So the idea is that if I now do the same mapping here, you see that the number of k values that are contributing here, right, is these many. Okay, these many delta functions will arise for the energies near the Brillouin zone edge. But for energies close to the k tending to zero, it's only this. These many k values are contributing to this omega. Correct? So what that is telling you is that as you go towards this region, which is getting flatter and flatter, you should actually get a density of states which is getting higher and higher. Okay, so the density of states should qualitatively look something like, you know, here it's all linear, so it should be something finite. But then as you go towards the Brillouin zone edge, because it is curving and becoming flatter, the density of state should actually increase and it should become something like this. Okay, now what was the, so let me now ask one second. I'm just trying to look at the names. Okay. Is Anustup here? Hello? Anustup is not around. Okay. Let me call Unnimaya. Is Unnimaya online?
Yes, sir.
Okay. So, Unnimaya, can you tell me what would be the density of states for this 1D monatomic lattice if I had taken the Debye model?
Okay, using Debye model.
Yeah. We derived that in the last slide, isn't it?
So, I am here.
Ah, you're here. Okay, Anustup, good. So, I'll ask you next time then, okay?
Okay, sir. Okay.
Yeah. So, Unnimaya, what would be the density of states for a monatomic 1D lattice if we had chosen the Debye model? See, here we have taken the real density, real dispersion, which is sine squared ka by 2, which is actually getting flat near the Brillouin zone edge. But in the Debye model, we take it linear all the way through. Okay? Okay. And if we take it linear all the way through, we get a certain density of states, which we had derived in the last slide. Right?
Okay, okay, yeah.
So what was the density of states we got there for the Debye model?
It was V by
omega to the power. There was something, right? Omega to the power something.
Yeah, omega to the,
let me remind you, it was omega to the power d minus 1.
Yes.
Okay, where d is the dimension of the system, right? So, yeah. With this answer, tell me what would be omega to the power 0, right? So if d is, yes, 1, then omega to the power 0, which means it's a constant.
Yes.
Correct? So if we had taken the Debye model, the density of states would have been just a constant.
Yeah.
Okay? But with this real dispersion, the density of states is actually strongly dependent on energy. And in fact, what you can see is that the strong dependence on energy is actually coming from this Brillouin zone edge, where the dispersion is not linear, right? And in fact, what we will see is that, so thank you, Unnimaya, you can mute yourself. So what we will see is actually near the Brillouin zone edge, we will get a singularity in the density of states. So as the density, as the dispersion becomes flatter and flatter and becomes more and more nonlinear, you will actually see a huge deviation from the flat density of states exactly at the Brillouin zone edge. And this is what is called a Van Hove singularity. Van Hove singularity. And these play a very important role in many phenomena. Okay? Because it turns out that the density of states becomes extremely large near the Van Hove singularities. This is what happens in 1D. In 2D and 3D, if you look at the structure of these Van Hove singularities, they don't look like divergences. Okay? There will be either a log divergence in 2D, for example, and in 3D, it just becomes a kink. It looks like this. Okay? So, in 1D, there is something called a square root divergence. In 2D, there is something called a logarithmic divergence. And in 3D, it becomes just a non-differentiable point. Yes.
Sir, can you just draw the two pictures in left? I cannot see this because there are number of participants. So 2D and 3D, I cannot see the singularity.
Oh, really? Okay, okay. Fine. Okay. Yeah, so then I think I should restrict this one, is it? Okay, sorry. One second. Yeah. So I was saying that, I was talking about the electronic case. In fact, it turns out that in the electronic case also you get similar density of states. Okay, you get something like this. And what we will see is that the form of this divergence is actually 1 over root e minus e0. Okay, so this is called a square root divergence in 1D. In 2D, we see something called a logarithmic divergence. So if you look at the form of this, this will go as log e minus log e. And the logarithmic divergence is actually weaker than a square root divergence. And in 3D, it turns out that you will not get any of these. You will not get a full divergence, but you will find kinks like this. Okay, so these kinks are basically points where the density of states is not differentiable, but it is continuous. Okay? So these Van Hove singularities, we will now see how they arise. Okay, and basically the picture that I want to tell you is that if you take a completely linear dispersion, you get a flat density of states. Okay, in 1D. But if you consider the real dispersion, which is not linear, then the parts where the dispersion or where the dispersion is non-linear, that is going to contribute very strongly to the frequency dependence of the density of states. Okay, so this is a concept that will need a little bit of digestion for those who have not encountered this concept before. So please make sure that you understand the relation between density of states and the dispersion and do a little bit of derivation by yourself. Because these concepts are extremely important in any properties that you try to understand. Okay, if you are planning to do research in this subject, then the concept of density of states is going to hit you again and again and again. So it's very important to understand the concept of density of states. And the concept of density of states is not limited to just periodic systems. You can have quantum dots which can have density of states. You can have polymers which can have density of states, 1D polymers. You can have disordered systems which can have density of states. So the momentum as an index is not important, or it's not limiting the concept of density of states. Okay, so do understand the meaning of the density of states concept. It's a very, very important concept. And it determines a lot of properties of the system. The thermodynamics, the transport, magnetic properties, all kinds of things. Okay, so do make sure that you understand. So let's just look at the density of states for this monatomic 1D lattice. So again, we will do some more k delta of omega minus omega k. And here we will do some more k delta of omega minus 2 root k by m sine k a by 2. Now I have removed the mod because I'm going to restrict the k only from 0 to pi by a. Okay, remember k is not restricted, right? But what I'm going to do is I'm going to restrict k from 0 to pi by a and then put a 2 here. Okay, the reason is you can see that this part and this part both are going to contribute equally. So plus k and minus k are going to contribute equally, and that will give us a factor of 2. So given this, now we will simplify this further and we will write this as 2 divided by 2 root k by m sum over k of delta of omega minus sine k a by 2. Okay. So now here we have a function of the k. So let's convert this to an integral and we will get root m by k integral over dk over 2 pi by l times delta of omega minus sine k a by 2. Now let me just erase some part. Second. Okay. Right. So can somebody tell me what should I do now next to find this delta function integral? So Anustup, you are the next in line. So can you tell me what should I do now? Are you familiar with the delta function?
Yes, sir.
Good. So tell me, how should I proceed now? How should I simplify this?
Say, I think it will turn out to be sine, some function of sine.
What will turn out to be the d of omega?
Yes, sir.
No, not really. Actually, the sine function does not directly come out. See, remember, the integral of f of x times delta of x minus x0 dx is f of x0. Okay. But now what we are dealing with here is that we are dealing with something like this, delta of f of x. We are dealing with something like this. Right? Because we are integrating over k and then inside the delta function there is a function of k.
Okay, okay? Sir.
So do you know how to simplify this kind of an expression?
No, sir.
Okay, that's okay. So it's not a very common thing to encounter this. So let me tell you the answer. It's actually sum over I.
So we have to find out the zeros for which
exactly.
The effect is zero.
Very good. May I know who is this?
Purnendu.
Okay. So delta of x minus xi, yeah, divided by f prime of xi. Class. F prime of xi. So these xi's are basically the roots of the function f of x. So substitute f of x is equal to 0. Okay. Find out how many places the f of x is 0. And those will be called xi's. These are the zeros or the roots of f of x is equal to 0. Okay. And at each of those xi's, find the derivative of f of x. That goes into the denominator. And this then reduces to sum over I of the delta function at each of those roots. So here we will apply this particular formula. So let's find out omega is equal to sine ka by 2. Right. Where does this get satisfied? Okay. So first of all, you can see that this will be satisfied only for omega between minus 1 to 1. Right. So this can be satisfied only for omega between minus 1 to 1. And for all other omega, which are greater than 1, this relation can never be satisfied. Okay. So already you are getting a restriction on omega. And that restriction is expressed by something called a theta function. And this theta function, I will express it like this. Oh, by the way, nobody corrected me. When I did this division, then I should have written here omega. So 2 root k by m, I took it out, right? So I should have got here omega root m by 2 root k. Omega times root m by 4k. Okay. So let's call this some omega bar, where omega bar is given by omega times root m by 4k. And that is what is entering here. Okay, so this is omega bar actually. Is everybody clear on this? Are there any doubts? No doubts, right? Good. Okay. So now we have to find out where does this omega bar become equal to sine ka by 2, and to invert this, sorry, we will just get k equal to 2 by a sine inverse of omega bar. So at those points, this inside function goes to zero. So what we would get then is delta of k minus k. So let's call this k of omega bar, right? Divided by mod of the f dash. So we have to take the derivative of this at the k omega bar. What is the derivative of this with respect to k? It's just cos k a by 2 into a by 2. Okay, so a by 2 into cos k a by 2, and this k is this special k omega bar, right? And this is what we have to integrate over dk, right? Is this clear? Is this step clear? If there are any doubts, please let me know. Okay, don't hesitate.
So can you explain it again?
Yeah, sure. So what we are saying is there is a function here which is omega minus. So let me consider. Let's just do it realistically. So we want to do this. Okay. Now we are using this particular formula, that the delta of f of k is given by delta of k minus ki divided by f dash of ki, some more I. So this ki is basically the root of f of k equal to 0, okay? Which means that we have to take this as the function of k and put that equal to 0, which means we will get omega bar equal to sine ka by 2, okay? And this relation can be satisfied for only for omega bar which lies between minus 1 to 1, not for anything else, because the sine function is bounded between minus 1 to 1. And that gives us a theta function, which is theta of 1 minus mod omega bar. Okay, so this comes purely from the bounded nature of the sine function. Next, we have to take the function itself and put that equal to 0 and find the roots of this function, right, with respect to k. So at what values of k does this function go to 0? So from that we find that the k value at which it goes to 0 is given by k equal to 2 by a sine inverse of omega bar, right? So then we can write this as delta of k minus 2 by a sine inverse of omega bar, okay, divided by the f prime of, so let's call this some k, this whole thing as some k naught, right? Then we have to take the derivative of this function at k naught. Okay, and there is only one root in this. So to find this, okay, so what we have to do is we have to find this. So let's take the same relation, right, and then invert this and find out what is the f dash. So f dash becomes cos k 0 a by 2. Okay, that's the derivative. But then we know that sine k naught a by 2 is just omega bar, right? So from this we can find out cos k naught a by 2 is square root of 1 minus omega bar squared. Okay, so this is something that we will substitute here, right? And so this is where the square root divergence comes from, okay? So the d of omega then becomes integral over dk delta of k minus k0 divided by square root of 1 minus omega bar squared, okay? And there is a theta function outside, and there are some constants also. So basically what you see is that this is proportional to theta of 1 minus mod omega bar divided by square root of 1 minus omega bar squared. Okay, so this is the interesting thing, that when omega bar tends towards 1, right, this whole function is actually blowing up. right? So which means when I plot the d of omega versus omega bar, okay, then you see that at plus minus 1 there is a square root divergence. So this function is diverging as a square root. But then what happens when omega bar is 0? When omega bar is 0, then this function is finite. So it cuts the intercept, the y-axis, at a finite value, and then it looks something like this. Okay, so this is the density of states for a realistic monotonic lattice. And you can see that it is diverging exactly near the boundaries or the band edges. So these are called the band edges. And we can ask, where does this divergence come from? Okay, and to see that, let me give you a more general argument. Okay, and this will tell us, where do Van't Hoff singularities actually come from? Is this expression clear to everyone? I mean, I think that was Purnendu, right, who asked the question. I'm trying to do voice recognition here.
No, that is understood.
Anustup, okay, sorry, yeah, I think that was closely spaced, so I didn't resolve. Okay, so is the derivation clear now, or is there any step which is not clear?
Sir, what will be the property of the theta function here?
Okay, fine. So a theta function is actually defined, let me remove some parts. See, the theta function is basically a step function, right? This you know, right? Theta function is defined as a step function, which is 0 for all x less than 0, and it's 1 for all x greater than 0. Okay, discontinuous here. So all we are saying now is that if there is a theta of something, right, then it is 1 for x greater than or equal to 0, and it is 0 for x less than 0. Now here you see that the omega bar minus sin k a by 2 is entering inside the delta function. Okay, so if I fix an omega bar, right, let's say equal to 2, then can I get any k value for which omega bar or for which this delta function argument will become 0? And the answer is no, because the sine function is bounded between minus 1 to 1. Do you agree?
Yes, right? Sir.
And remember, the delta of x blows up only when x is 0. So only when the argument of the delta function becomes 0 will I get a divergence. Okay, so I have to find out whether there exists any k value for which the omega bar minus sin k a by 2 becomes equal to 0 or not. And if the omega bar becomes greater than 1 or becomes less than minus 1, then I will not find any root of this argument. And that particular restriction is being expressed by the theta function. Okay, so what this theta function is doing is that it's saying 1 minus mod of omega bar should be greater than or equal to 0, which means that mod of omega bar should be less than or equal to 1. Which means that the density of states is non-zero only between minus 1 and 1 in these scaled units. And there are no states outside this energy range. Now, how do you understand this? To understand this, let's go back to the dispersion again. If you see the dispersion, the omega k is non-zero only between this value and this value. If I ask you, are there any acoustic phonons for an omega k which is greater than this? Are there any k states here? What would be your answer?
No.
No, right? So there are actually no states here which are giving you any finite dispersion, right? So there are no states here at all. Okay?
Yes.
And the other thing is, if I had included the mod here, see, remember, the dispersion was actually given by a mod of sin k a by 2. Okay? So if there had been a mod, then the omega bar cannot even be negative. Right? So the density of states that I have drawn here is actually valid only for the only for electrons, actually. It turns out that electrons also have a similar property, right? But for phonons, this is not correct, and I wanted somebody to correct me, but the dispersion is purely this. Okay, it's finite here and it diverges here. There is nothing on the negative side, because remember the omega k was just mod of 2 root k by m mod of sine ka by 2. So because of the mod on the sine function, you will only have positive energies and no negative energies, which means there is no density of states for negative this one, and the theta function will be just 1 minus omega. Okay. So, so let me now take you to the general concept of the Wanner singularity and where the density of states can diverge, and that's where we will end this. So let me clear this. Okay. So let's write this d of omega is sum over k delta of
sir, what was the argument there that we cannot have state in k less than 0 or k less than 0?
Not k less than 0. No. So k less than 0, you can have states. Sorry, let me clarify this. Yeah. But for omega less than 0, you don't have states.
Okay.
See, the dispersion is this, right? And we are saying that for omega less than 0, there are no states. And for omega greater than this value, again, there are no states. So the dispersion is non-zero, or the density of states is non-zero only for this particular energy range.
Yeah,
that's all. Okay, so now let's write this as d d k divided by 2 pi by l to the power d times delta of omega minus omega k. So this is a full general expression for the density of states, which includes, for example, the full k dependence, the full vector k dependence of omega on k. There could also be a branch index here, okay? And then you would get, for specific branches, you would get specific density of states. You can do this for optical branch, you can do this for transverse optical, acoustic, and so on, okay? So this is a full general expression. So this would be omega in the d-dimensional space and 2 pi to the power d times integral d dk delta of omega minus omega alpha k. Okay, now who is left out in this? Did I talk to Sohini? No. Is Sohini Chatterjee online?
Yes, sir.
Hi, Sohini. So tell me something. What parts of the dispersion should we expect the largest contribution to the density of states?
Towards the flattened part.
Exactly. Very good. So in the flattened part, that's where we saw that the density of states is getting the largest contribution, correct? So what you said is, in this part, if we look at the density of states near these energies, right, where the dispersion is getting flat, that is where the maximum contribution to the density of states is coming from. Okay. So can we generalize this argument to a general dispersion and in d dimensions? Can we say from which parts of the Brillouin zone will we get the largest contribution to the density of states in d dimensions?
At the boundaries of the Brillouin zone, the edges.
1D dispersion to a d-dimensional system, correct? What you are saying is, in a 1D system, the dispersion is flat near the Brillouin zone edge, and maybe similar thing will happen even for higher dimensions. But actually, that's not completely true, okay? So you can have flat regions even in the center of the Brillouin zone, even, you know, somewhere in the middle of the Brillouin zone. So that can also happen. But how is flatness defined? That's the question. See, the flatness was the important property, isn't it? Wherever the dispersion becomes flat, that's where the maximum contribution comes from, right? So how do you represent flatness?
Sir, where VG we found group velocity d omega by dk is 0.
Correct. So if we look at this part, then we can say d omega k by dk is going to 0. Okay. Now, how do we generalize this to higher dimensions?
Where the gradient
becomes 0. Gradient. So, where the gradient of omega goes to 0. Okay. So, wherever the gradient of the omega goes to 0, that's where we would get the divergence in the density of states, or that is called the Van Hove singularity. Okay, Van Hove singularity. Now, how do we see that mathematically? It's easy to see that because remember, the formula for the delta of f of x had a denominator, okay, which had the derivative of the function. Right, and that gets generalized in higher dimensions to the gradient. So basically, this will involve delta of k minus ki divided by mod of gradient of omega alpha k sum over I. Right, and these gradients are calculated at these roots. Okay, so basically you can see that whenever this gradient diverges, goes to 0, the density of states will basically diverge. Okay, so this is now a function of omega. So these points where the dispersion goes, where the dispersion is flat, that's what contributes to the Van Hove singularity, and that you can find even without doing the full calculation. Just take the dispersion, take the gradient, and see where the gradient goes to 0. Okay, and in those parts of the Brillouin zone will contribute to the Van Hove singularities in the density of states. Okay, so is this argument clear, that Van Hove singularities are characterized by the vanishing of the gradient of the dispersion? Anyone who is not who did not understand this? Very good. Okay, so the density of states concept ends here. So what is the main message? See, the density of states depends strongly on the dimension. In different dimensions, you will get different dependencies on the frequency or on the energy. The density of states depends strongly on the type of dispersion you are using. If it is a flat dispersion, if it is a linear dispersion, if it's a non-linear dispersion, each of them will give you different kinds of density of states. Okay, and the concept of density of states is very important. It's useful in many different contexts: transport, thermodynamics, response functions, etc. So one needs to know what is the density of states, and this is also an experimentally you can find these quantities experimentally directly. Okay, for example, there is something called a tunneling experiment where you can measure the density of states of a surface directly. Okay, so there are many other experiments also. For example, there are photo emission experiments, angle resolved photo emission experiments, where you can get the density of states directly. Okay, so this is an experimentally measurable quantity, and it also gives us a lot of information about the response of the system. So let's end this today, and then tomorrow we'll take up Raman scattering. Okay, and then after Raman scattering, we will go over to electronic systems. So until now, we've been looking at phonon systems. Tomorrow, we'll look at the interaction of electromagnetic radiation with matter, and there we will come across Raman scattering. Then after that, if we finish that tomorrow itself, then we'll start electronic systems. So, okay, we are done.
Sir, if the gradient becomes zero,
right,
then how will I calculate the integral?
So, okay, let's go back to the 1D example then. Okay. So in the 1D example, what did we do? So in the 1D example also, we had a sine ka by 2, right? And the sine ka by 2 became cos ka by 2, if we take the derivative with respect to k. Okay. So now, that was in the denominator, remember. And the cos k by 2, we converted that to energy. So that became square root of 1 minus omega bar squared. Do you agree?
Yes.
So calculating the integral itself was not a difficult thing. Remember, because what we did was, these are delta functions. And all we had to do was, we had to find out where this function went to zero, where this function vanished. So find the roots in terms of k, right? And then substitute that in the denominator. So basically, this will get reconverted back to energy space. So this will become again some function of omega. But that function of omega will go to zero, okay? And that will give rise to divergence in the density of states at certain energies. This will not go to zero everywhere. This will go to zero only at specific energies. So, for example, here you are seeing that omega bar equal to 1 represents a divergence. Okay. In higher dimensions, you will see that this function will not exactly, this function, even if it goes to 0, you will see that there is a factor here which is ddk. Okay. And this ddk contributes k to the power d minus 1 times dk in spherical polar coordinates. And this will help you to kill the square root divergence in higher dimensions. Okay, so this is something that you will have to convince yourself mathematically. But in 3D, it turns out that these square root divergences, or even in 2D, the square root divergence doesn't occur. What you get is a logarithmic divergence in 2D, and it will be just a kink in 3D. Okay, so. But this volume element is responsible for transforming the singularities into, you know, more smoother singularities, so to say, in higher dimensions. Is that clear?
Okay, sir.
Yeah.
Okay, sir.
Yeah. Okay. See you guys tomorrow then.
Thank you, sir.